Welcome to today's session of the Midnight Club. Wine? Chamomile tea? Whatever you choose, the only limit to these stories is your imagination. But chances are, you want answers. What was that hourglass symbol all about? What do those stories mean? And who is Dr. Stanton? There's plenty of firewood, scares, and spoilers on the way. So pull up a chair and let's dive deep into the twisted tales of the latest addition to the Netflix Flanaverse. Before we start to unpick some creepy, culty threads, let's do a quick bit of background on the Midnight Club itself. For plenty of 90s kids out there, that opening font is a serious throwback to library trips and school book fairs gone by. Christopher Pike's series of books were essential for early teens in the 1990s who wanted something scarier than Goosebumps. We even see a couple of flashes of a frame very similar to the original front cover early on in the first episode. It's no accident that there are all of those X-Files references, brightly coloured IMAX, and even excitement for the upcoming PlayStation.
Folie à deux. It means, delusion shared by two.
You speak French?
No, but it was the title of an X-Files episode, and it was awesome.
Oh, and if you're looking for classic horror references, on top of those glimpses of Fangoria magazine and Stephen King Dead Zone paperbacks, Dr. Stanton is played by none other than Heather Langenkamp. She's the legendary horror actress who faced off against Freddy Krueger in A Nightmare on Elm Street, the third in the series Dream Warriors, and pre-Scream 90s meta sequel Wes Craven's New Nightmare. For the purpose of the series, the Midnight Club, as it is in the book, is a gathering of terminally ill teens telling each other scary stories in front of the fire. But in Mike Flanagan's version, the tales they tell are actually from other Christopher Pike stories. They're in the episode titles, but you'll find Hitchhikers, Poppycorn and Freedom Jack in the book Road to Nowhere, and Dusty and his trusty hammer are within the pages of Wicked Heart.
What the fuck?
So, yes, if something feels familiar, you haven't previously accidentally read the future. Don't worry, you're not a cyborg. Probably. And this is exceptionally meta storytelling. Not only are these tales about love, loss, fate, queerness, sacrifice, and obviously horror, themes that run especially deep for our main characters stuck at Brightcliffe, but they're led by these teens. And this means that no one is afraid to jump in when there are the wrong kind of jump scares, or badly named sports teams.
The Seabirds and the Rushers.
Do you think those are real football teams?
I don't care. I don't like sports.
Mike Flanagan is toying with the concept of story itself and the power of imagination and reality.
Did you hear that music?
What music?
This is especially poignant when it comes to Anya. As she becomes even more unwell, the group attempt a ritual Ilonka has found in a book in the library. We'll get onto the origins of the book in a minute, but once the ritual has taken place, we see a shadowy figure descend on Anya. In the next episode, Anya is seemingly cured, and it's 3 years on in 1997. She's working at a supermarket, but is desperately unhappy, missing her friends, who are now long dead. It's only as the episode progresses that we see that she lives in the world of the Midnight Club's stories. The video game shop from Amish's story is here, Dandy's mother and a hammer, the screaming horror of Spencer's story from the first episode, and even Anya's own creation, the ballet dancer Dana, who makes a dangerous pact with the devil. This is all a story too. Anya's nightly radio alarm clock, set for midnight, suddenly broadcasts the group through the radio of the recovery room.
Hello, Anya.
We're seeing the universe of her imagination before she passes, giving us an insight into a world where she survives, but also the sad truth of one where she does not.
P.S. Sorry about the ashes. Fucking dramatic, right? I've gone supernova.
I As explained in episode 5, when Ilonka finds what she calls the Paragon Diaries, the source of the ritual the group try and use for Anya, the Paragon was a cult started by a woman called Regina Ballard in the 1930s. It started off innocently enough, with natural healing, but Regina became obsessed with 5 specific Greek goddesses, especially Asseco, the ancient Greek goddess of healing. The Paragon embraced the symbol of the hourglass, which represents an endless loop of time as long as you keep turning it over. Taking on the name Asseco, Regina led a ritual in the basement of Brightcliffe, sacrificing 4 women to prolong her life, effectively turning over her own hourglass. Regina's daughter, Athena, escaped, saving the children and alerting the police, who discovered the grisly scene. Regina said it was an accident, but we're not sure how accidental all the blood and poison looked in the eyes of the law. Regardless, Brightcliffe is left abandoned until Dr. Stanton buys it in the 1960s, transforming it into a hospice. She's particularly fitting here then to head up a house where often dreams feel like reality and vice versa.
Welcome to Brightcliffe.
This leads us nicely to the desires of Julia Jayne. She gives Ilonka a fake name when she initially meets her in the woods and raves about the natural powers of the water and the chamomile that grows there. Ilonka already knew of Julia Jayne, a girl who allegedly went missing in the woods before coming back to Brightcliffe after a week, apparently cured. And she'd do anything to be able to do the same thing. As we find out, to Ilonka's horror, this mysterious woman is Julia Jayne, who, instead of going out into the woods and undergoing a ritual, actually hunted down the now far older Regina Ballard, or Asseco. Regina tells her to return to Brightcliffe through the woods, as if a miracle has taken place. We don't know exactly what the pair did though before Julia returned, apparently cured, but we do know that Regina called Julia a bright girl, just like Julia has been calling Ilonka.
I can still see some light in your eyes. Bright girl.
Back in the 90s, Ilonka helps Julia get into Brightcliffe, only to discover that she's happy to poison everyone in the basement to get another shot at the ritual.
Life can prevail. That is what the Paragon was trying to do. They got lost along the way.
The Midnight Club loves to play with our expectations as well as our emotions. Can everything here be explained logically? As is always the case with Mike Flanagan's work, we would rather believe in the supernatural to save us from the fear and terror of merely being human. Something that Natsuki teaches us in Road to Nowhere.
I thought I wanted to die. But I survived and I realized how much I wanted to live. I found out I was dying anyway.
At times, it does seem that any ghostly goings-on do have a rational explanation. Sandra isn't cured in Anya's ritual, but was merely misdiagnosed. Spencer's ghostly radio interaction was Sandra trying to give him a belief in something otherworldly. And Anya herself says in her letter to the group that if the afterlife does allow communication, she'll be sending them far clearer messages than just vague shapes. While she doesn't appear to them though, Ilonka discovers that Anya's prized ballet statue is no longer smashed and has somehow been repaired. And there are further unexplainable goings-on. The shadowy figures that wait for the teenagers as death creeps closer. And there are time slips as Ilonka travels to a grainy, older version of Brightcliffe. She finds herself drawn to the basement where she meets Kevin, who has been doing the same thing. The group tries to say the pair have a shared delusion, or folie à deux, but that doesn't stop them from describing the same milky-eyed elderly couple they keep seeing in mirrors and in their dreams. brings us nicely to the couple in this picture in the final moments of the series. This framed 1898 newspaper clipping celebrating the construction of Brightcliff features Stanley Oscar Freeland and Vera Freeland, and they just happen to be identical to the terrifying apparitions from both Ilonka and Kevin's nightmares. This suggests that even prior to the Paragon, Brightcliff has known horror. Either that or Aseko's rituals have awoken something else in the building. And finally, let's look at Dr. Stanton, specifically the back of her neck. In the final reveal of the series, we see that she's not only bald, so potentially undergoing treatment for an undisclosed disease, but she has a tattoo of the symbol of the Paragon. Given her fury at Julia Jayne's incursion, she's certainly not on her side, and she genuinely seems to care for the teenagers of Brightcliff, especially constantly rationalising life for Ilonka. But she definitely knows far more about the Paragon than she's let on. Looking at the numbers alone, she's too young to be Athena, Aseko's daughter in the 1930s, but she could easily be her daughter, restarting the cult at the site of the original ritual. Or, let's hope Natsuki isn't right.
Maybe she's super evil, and she really just started this place so she could watch other people suffer.
Well, that's all the answers we have for now, as this video hourglass sand drains away. Check out Still Watching Netflix for more on your favourite shows and movies.